Hello, and welcome to this evening's Delta Conveyance Project informational webinar on climate change. My name is Juliana Brokoff. I work for Ag Innovations, and I'll be facilitating this evening's webinar. Before we get started, I'll walk through how to get into the Spanish language channel and access the translated presentation. I'll then turn things over to Reina Rodriguez with Lingüística. We'll go over the Spanish translation logistics for this evening, including the information I'm about to provide. Next slide. To switch to the Spanish channel, click on the interpretation icon at the bottom of your screen and choose Spanish. To view or download the translated version of this presentation, go to the informational webinars page on the Delta Conveyance section of the Delta of the Department of Water Resource website. The website is on the slide. Once you're on that page, scroll down to the Información en Español section, where you will find a link to the presentation under the header for this evening's webinar. Let me turn it over to Reina.
Muy buenas noches a todos. Si usted nos está escuchando esta noche y le gustaría escuchar la transmisión completamente en español, vamos a tener interpretación simultánea a través de la reunión. Para accesar la interpretación en español, favor de hacer, de seleccionar el icono que parece un mundo abajo de su pantalla. Después de que seleccione el icono que parece un mundo, va a seleccionar español y por último le pido ponga el audio original en silencio para que de esta manera no escuche un eco y estará listo, lista para participar completamente en español. Le invitamos a que someta cualquier pregunta que usted tenga en su lenguaje de preferencia y aquí estaremos para ayudar a facilitar la conversación. If you are joining us tonight and you are a monolingual English speaker only, we will have an open comment question section where we do invite you to select interpretation in English if you would like to. This way, if we do have any Spanish comments, you would be able to hear the interpretation in real time. If you are using a phone or an iPad, your options are going to be a little different. Instead of selecting the icon that looks like a world at the bottom of your screen, you're actually going to select the three little dots that say more. And sometimes they're on your upper right-hand corner, sometimes they're on your lower right-hand corner. And that way you could also join the interpretation channel. Si usted está utilizando un celular o una tableta esta noche para escuchar la transmisión en español, le invito a que seleccione los tres puntitos que están en su pantalla que dicen More o indicando más opciones y entonces usted va a seleccionar lenguaje, interpretación, español y por último, no lo olvide poner el audio original en silencio y oprimir listo. Gracias, bienvenidos.
Thank you, Reina. A few more logistical items before we get into the format and the agenda. This webinar is being recorded and closed captioning is available by clicking on the CC icon on the bottom of your screen, and then click on that icon and then choose the enable option. The presentations for this evening are currently available on the Department of Water Resources website, and they were also sent out this afternoon. To view or download those presentations, go to the informational webinars page on the Delta Conveyance section of the Department of Water Resources website. The website link is on this slide. Once you're on that page, scroll down to the topics, schedule, and registration section, and you will find a link to the presentation under the header for this evening's webinar. We will also make the video recording of this event available on the Department of Water Resources website. In a moment, Carrie Buckman with the Department of Water Resources will talk more about the purpose of these webinars, but I'll start by describing the format and the agenda. You will hear a series of technical presentations, and then you'll have an opportunity to ask clarifying questions on the information that's presented. Presentations will be given on the California Environmental Quality Act, CEQA, process, climate change planning in California, including the Department of Water Resources response, and how climate change will be addressed in the Environmental Impact Report, the EIR. If you have a question during any of the presentation portions, you can submit your questions through the Q&A feature in Zoom. You go to the bottom of your screen, of your Zoom screen, click on the Q&A icon, and type your questions into the box. Following each presentation, there'll be a short period where written questions are addressed. If we don't get to all of the questions during that time, we'll try to answer them at the end of the webinar. Following all the presentations, there will be an opportunity for you to ask verbal questions. To do that, you'll raise your hand by clicking on the raise hand icon at the bottom of your screen. When you click on the icon, we'll see your name. I'll call on your name and we'll unmute your mic, and you have to unmute your mic also. And you will have 2 minutes to ask your question verbally. I'll do my best to call on people in the order in which their hands are raised, but there's a lot of you, so I'll just try to do my best. For those of you who are participating by phone, you can raise your hand by pressing *9 and then *6 to unmute yourself. Again, we'll try to address all the questions that are asked this evening, either through the chat function or through verbally at the end, but it's unlikely that we'll be able to get to all your questions due to the number of people in attendance. If you have a question that we don't have a chance to answer tonight, or you think of something after the event, please email deltaconveyance@water.ca.gov. The Department of Water Resources has been keeping track of all those questions, and they will post a frequently asked questions document on the project website to answer any clarifying questions related to the topic of this webinar. Just to remind you, this is not a formal CEQA public input opportunity. There will be opportunities for public input once the draft environmental impact report has been released for public review in mid-2022. The purpose of these webinars is to provide background information that will help you when you review the draft environmental impact review when it is available. Please focus your questions on clarifying information that will help you review the draft EIR. Now I'm going to turn things over to Carrie Buckman, the Delta Conveyance Project Environmental Program Manager with the Department of Water Resources. She will give you a brief presentation on the proposed project, which will include details on the overall schedule, the planning process, and future opportunities for public participation. She'll also provide information on the CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act process, and how these webinars relate to that formal process. Carrie.
Thanks, Juliana. So before I launch into slides, just a couple of opening thoughts. I really wanted to start by saying thank you for coming. Welcome. We really, really appreciate that you're taking time to come listen to this webinar and participate in this webinar. I think I say this every time, but I really mean it. I know everyone has other things that they'd probably rather be doing with their evening. And so we really appreciate that you're taking the time to come participate here. Thank you. I'm going to start with some introductory material about the purpose of these webinars, a quick overview of the project, and some information about CEQA. For those of you that participated in the last few webinars, this will be a repeat, but we'll try to keep it short and move on to the new content. The purpose of these webinars is to provide some background on technical topics well in advance of the release of the draft environmental impact report, or EIR. The goal is to share the methodology we will use and the assumptions we will make when evaluating the environmental effects of the project. We understand that these issues can be very technical and complicated, and it's our hope that these informational webinars will help clarify these topics and help members of the public in reviewing the draft EIR when it becomes available next year. We know and we understand that there are very strong sentiments about this project and that there is a high degree of interest in making those feelings known. As Juliana said earlier, these meetings are really meant to provide an opportunity to ask questions to clarify our approach to the environmental analysis. I'd encourage you as much as possible to take advantage of the opportunity to ask questions of our technical experts. We're really glad that they're here and they're able to interact with you guys. And we'd like to preserve as much of the Q&A portion of the meeting as possible for those types of clarifying questions. There will, of course, be a formal public review period once the draft EIR is published and many opportunities for public comments on that draft. Tonight, we do not have results yet. So we are in the process of evaluating impacts of the project. And so we don't know yet what those impacts are. We're not ready to share any information. We don't have potential mitigation. We're able to share methods and assumptions and background. The results will be in the draft EIR that will be out next year. And again, there will be chances to comment at that point. And finally, I'd like to note that we understand that there is a high degree of interest in many water issues right now, particularly drought and also other serious water-related issues facing California. I'd really like to focus, though, on Delta Conveyance. So tonight, we're going to try to really focus on Delta Conveyance and not address those many other topics. So with that, I will jump into a couple of slides about the project. Again, we're just providing a quick overview so that you can understand some of the discussion that will follow. So the reasons that DWR is considering the Delta Conveyance Project are included on this slide, sort of the fundamental purpose as to why we're considering it. So the purpose is to modernize the aging State Water Project or SWP infrastructure in the Delta to restore and protect the reliability of SWP water deliveries in a cost-effective manner consistent with the state's water resilience portfolio. And specifically, we're trying to have the State Water Project continue to function in the face of many, many challenges. And so those are reflected in our objectives. We're trying to help address sea level rise and climate change, minimize water supply disruption due to seismic risk, protect water supply reliability, and provide operational flexibility to improve aquatic conditions. So I'm going to talk really quickly about the potential project alternatives. Very generally, what the project would include is intakes from the Sacramento River and then a tunnel connecting those intakes to the South Delta. The tunnel would follow one of the routes shown on this map, either a central corridor that goes through the Central Delta or an eastern corridor that goes with the blue line that's closer to I-5. The central and eastern corridors would come together into a southern forebay, the south of this figure. The idea is there would be a pumping facility up into a southern forebay that would regulate flows between the tunnel and the pumping plant up into the bank's pumping plant up into the California aqueduct. The Bethany alternative is a little different. The Bethany alternative would start following the same tunnel alignment as the eastern corridor, but would instead head more directly south with a pumping plant directly up into Bethany Reservoir and no southern forebay because we wouldn't need to re-regulate flows. There would only be one pumping plant. The tunnel capacity could range. The proposed project is 6,000 CFS, but it could range from 3,000 to 7,500. And the number of intakes in the North Delta would vary based on that size. Currently, we're working on this project schedule, so we're working towards having a draft EIR in mid-2022. Additionally, the Corps of Engineers is preparing a draft environmental impact statement under the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA, and they are working to have that draft EIS completed on a similar timeline. They will be different documents. As a regulatory agency, they wanted to have a separate environmental impact statement, but we're trying to have a similar public review period that overlaps so that the public can see both documents at once to try to help reduce the workload of having two documents. So we'll have a public review period, and then we will work to have a final EIR, EIS, record of decision, and notice of determination in late 2023. Concurrently, we're starting working on the other permitting processes. So we are starting to work on a biological assessment to comply with the Endangered Species Act and an incidental take permit application for the California Endangered Species Act. We're planning to submit those around the same time that we have the public draft EIR release, and then the fishery agencies would work on a biological opinion and ITP into 2023. We're also starting some of the early work towards a change in point of diversion for our water rights, Delta Plan consistency, and other environmental permits, but the main work of those will be in 2023 and 2024. So I'm also going to provide a quick overview of the CEQA process. CEQA is really a much longer and more complicated topic than I'm going to be able to go over tonight. And I did just want to flag that we have a longer presentation on DWR's website where we have a video of one of our CEQA experts talking about the things that are included in CEQA. This is really just sort of a quick foundation for tonight's discussion. So CEQA is a requirement for all public agencies subject to the jurisdiction of California to analyze impacts of a proposed project prior to approval. The idea is to evaluate what could happen to the environment in relation to the proposed project. So under CEQA, we disclose potential significant environmental impacts, identify ways to avoid or reduce significant environmental impacts, prevent environmental damage if feasible by requiring implementation of alternatives or mitigation measures, foster interagency coordination and public participation, and show that the agency is considering environmental implications of actions prior to making decisions. We are preparing an environmental impact report, or EIR, to analyze the potential impacts of the proposed project on physical environmental resources. The purpose of the EIR is to inform decision makers and the public about a project's potential significant environmental impacts and ways to avoid, reduce, or compensate for them. And it demonstrates that the environment is being considered and ensures the prevention of environmental damage where feasible by requiring implementation of feasible alternatives or mitigation measures. While EIRs vary a bit, there are sort of standard topics that are typically included and that we are planning to include. So we will include a project description of the proposed project as well as the alternatives. We'll describe the environmental setting, which will be the baseline for analysis of impacts. We'll then discuss the potential for significant environmental impacts, direct, indirect, or cumulative impacts. Where we have significant effects, we will identify potential mitigation measures. We'll also identify the potential for growth-inducing impacts. We'll look at alternatives and the potential for those to produce effects that are potentially different than the proposed project. And we'll document the organizations and people that we've consulted. And this slide shows an overview of the CEQA process. Walking through it really quickly, the first line talks about initial outreach. We filed a notice of preparation in January of 2020 and held scoping meetings. Then we documented that process in a scoping summary report and developed a plan to reach out to related agencies. On line two, this has been the bulk of the work in the last year. We've worked on identifying and formulating alternatives, defining the project, and we're working on technical reports to try to provide technical information needed. And the main focus right now, highlighted in yellow, is that we are analyzing potential impacts and mitigation. And this really is the focus of what we're going to talk about tonight, the idea that we want to talk about the methods that we're proposing to use and some of the background information that will help you understand that analysis process. We don't have results yet, but we will be able to talk about the methods and discuss those issues. From here, we'll move towards preparing a draft EIR. That will be released, as I mentioned, in mid-2022. At that point, highlighted in orange, that is a major opportunity for public outreach. We'll circulate the draft EIR and hold public meetings to talk about the draft EIR and hear comments on the draft EIR. And then we'll move towards the final by responding to comments, having a final EIR and a notice of determination. And back to Juliana. Thanks.
Thank you, Carrie. I'll now turn things over to Andrew Schwartz, the State Water Project Climate Action Advisor with the Department of Water Resources, who will give a presentation on climate change planning in California, including DWR's response. The Q&A feature is open for questions, which we will address following Andrew's presentation or later in the verbal Q&A portion of the meeting.
Thanks, Juliana. And thank you, Carrie, for that introduction. And I want to reiterate Carrie's comments, appreciating everybody's time and interest tonight in this topic. So I am going to talk, give an overview of the climate change impacts on California that we're already seeing, some of the projections for future impacts, and cover some of the things that DWR and the state as a whole are doing to address these impacts. I just want to start, we'll get into the details in a moment, but I just want to start talking about climate change at the most basic level. We've all heard of the greenhouse effect. This is the natural feature of our atmosphere and is actually responsible for making conditions on Earth habitable. Without the greenhouse effect, Earth would look more like Mars than the Earth that we know. And the greenhouse effect, what it is it's caused by a thin layer of atmospheric gases that allow solar radiation to come into the Earth, but then restrict some of it from leaving, keeping the Earth warm. The problem is that over the last 100 years or so, emissions of greenhouse gases like carbon dioxide and methane have been being released by human activities at increasing rates and have caused this thin layer of atmosphere to build up and become slightly thicker, trapping more of that solar radiation that would have left out into space and resulting in some warming of the planet. The fact that GHGs are causing enhanced warming of the climate system and that human activities are the cause of the increase in GHG concentrations in the atmosphere has now been validated by hundreds of studies using indicators and data from around the globe and is considered incontrovertible by the vast majority of the world's climate and atmospheric scientists. So before we talk about how climate is changing, we need to acknowledge that California's existing and historical climate have always been highly variable. Not only does precipitation vary greatly across the state, geographically north to south and coast to inland and mountains, and seasonally with very dry summers and wet winters, but California has more year-to-year variability in precipitation than anywhere else in the lower 48 states, as shown in the figure here. The darker colored areas represent where individual years vary more from the long-term average, and pink and yellow areas are areas where most years fall pretty close to the average. So you can see that Southern California in particular, but all of California in general, and particularly covering the Sierra Nevada region where we get most of our water supply from, is very highly variable year to year, as we're seeing in the last few years, where we've seen 2017 is one of the wettest years on record, on the heels of two of the driest periods, 2012 to 2016 drought, and now the two-year period that we find ourselves in today. In addition to California's interannual variability, California is uniquely difficult to predict in terms of how climate change will affect precipitation patterns. Global climate models have more disagreement about whether climate change will lead to more precipitation or less precipitation across California than nearly any other region of the United States. And this wide range of variability and predictability creates an additional challenge for California water managers. So now jumping into some of the impacts of climate change that we're already seeing out our windows. These are observed trends and data from measurements throughout the state. And in this figure from NOAA, it highlights how much temperatures have already changed. So this is not any projection of the future. This is what has already happened across California. You can see that for most of California, average temperatures are about 1 degree Fahrenheit warmer than they were just 10 years ago. That's a rate of change that is completely unprecedented in the historical record. Likewise, mean sea levels are 6 inches higher than they were 40 years ago. And precipitation is becoming more variable and more extreme at both the wet and dry end of the spectrum, as I just mentioned, with observed very wet and very dry periods just in the last 10 years. In terms of that temperature and precipitation change, this slide shows the 20th and 21st century observations for annual temperature, average temperature, and average annual precipitation. The gray dots represent 21st century observations, the blue dots, 20th century observations, and the triangle in the middle is the period of record, the full 100-year record average, and 2020 is shown in red there. But what you can see is all of those observations in gray are concentrated on the right-hand side of the graphic, showing that these years are all generally warmer than the earlier year records. And the precipitation is more or less scattered across the range, but we've only had 20 years of the 21st century where we had 80 observations from 1920 to 1999 in the 20th century. And you can see that we're already seeing some observations that are very high on the precipitation end and very low on the precipitation end. And we would expect that range to expand even further as we move further into the 21st century. Okay, so the next slide is showing California temperature, the header there is not correct. It's California statewide April 1st snowwater equivalent. And what you're seeing here is a very important measurement of our snowpack. So rain and stream flow are key aspects of our water supply. But California is unique, again, in that we have relatively small levels of surface storage in our system. And we depend on, and the system was actually designed with the snowpack in mind, assuming that that winter snowpack would stay high in the watershed until middle to late summer and spring, where it would be released slowly, could refill our reservoirs and be available for water supply later in the year. So we depend on this snowpack, and snow water equivalent is just a measure of the amount of water trapped in the snow. April 1st is the traditional annual key annual measurement because it's the end of the snow season and before the majority of melting has started to occur in the snowpack. And so April 1st is a key time of year to look at snowpack. And what we can see from this graphic is while this signal and the data are very noisy, we have very high snowpacks going up as high as 230 some percent of average down to just 5% of average. This trend line is disturbing in that it is decreasing considerably over the last 100 years. And we've seen in just the last 10 years, some very low snowpack numbers and many years below that 50% mark. So this is looking at the proportion of average annual precipitation that falls as rain. So this is again, kind of talking about that snowpack and whether the precipitation, even if the precipitation in general that we're getting is more or less average, and we don't detect a long-term trend yet in the amount of precipitation that we're getting. But what we do see is that the percentage of that precipitation that is falling as snow versus falling as rain is increasing, or the percentage that's falling as rain is increasing. And this means that more of that precipitation is falling as rain during winter, when we know we get most of our rain during winter, and it's falling and running off immediately through our reservoir system, and then all of our major reservoirs in California are multi-purpose reservoirs. And what that means is that during the winter season, they're managed for flood control to provide public benefits for flood, to detain water during big flow events, release it and allow, make sure that there's ample storage in those reservoirs to retain the next flood event. And so often we have to let, if we get additional precipitation in winter, we have to let that water pass through the reservoirs. We aren't able to hold it for water supply late in the season. And then when we get to the end of the flood control season in March and April, when we're able to refill those reservoirs, that precipitation that should have been snow, that's already gone. And so we lose that part of the water supply. And you can see from this graphic that we're seeing a considerable increase, particularly in the last decade or so, in the proportion of the precipitation that is falling as rain as opposed to snow. Okay, so we've talked a little bit now about some of the impacts that we're already seeing on our water system from climate change. Let's talk a little bit about projections of future climate change and the impacts we might see. But just as a little background to that, this slide that talks about where these modeling projections come from. So most of our projections come from GCMs or global climate models, or sometimes called general circulation models. And these are complex ocean and atmospheric models of the Earth system that use mathematical equations to solve these processes, or to mimic these processes, and to provide information about how the atmosphere is expected to evolve in the future. Global climate models in general are designed to provide general information for the global environment, and their resolution is too coarse to be used for most regional and local climate studies. So the information in these models is typically downscaled to a local or regional scale, and this usually involves observational information from the past to downscale the coarse information, the global scale, to a fine scale at a regional scale. And you can see the last kind of image in this graphic kind of shows you how the global climate model data is kind of in these big, if you played with Legos, these Duplo size blocks, and the finer resolution downscale data comes out looking more like those smaller Legos that we're more used to playing with as we grew up. Oh, one thing before, actually back to that slide, one thing I want to mention before we leave the modeling projections is the other big thing that goes into global climate model projections is greenhouse gas emissions assumptions. So these are sometimes called RCPs or representative concentration pathways you may have seen. So this is just assumptions about what will happen to the global emissions of greenhouse gases over the next 50 to 100 years. And that is really an unknown, an uncertainty. We don't know how global national governments will react and how citizens of the world will behave in terms of converting our energy systems to more renewable supplies, changing our transportation system, and how technologies will develop to facilitate that. And so there are different assumptions about, will we follow a path that is closer to the historical path of high GHG emissions, or will we change our behavior and really reduce greenhouse gas emissions and stop the continued warming of the system? And so you'll often see projections that have a kind of worst case, best case bookend situation. And that is often using a worst case scenario GHG emissions pathway or a best case GHG emissions pathway. The other uncertainty is that there are dozens and dozens of these global climate models put together by different research universities and governments throughout the world. And while they all are trying to mimic the same physics, they use different types of equations and different assumptions. And so they all come up with slightly different results. And so the best practice is to use more of those models to get a wider range of what might happen to cover your uncertainty range. And so that will also sometimes contribute to the range of outcomes that we might see in the future. So from these projections, we can start to look at what we might see in the future. And one of the biggest concerns that we have is loss of snowpack and that snow water equivalent that's trapped in that water supply. And so you can see in this panel, the historical range of April 1st snow water equivalent across the Sierra, and then a nearly 50% loss just in the best case scenario by the end of the century, or maybe as much as a 65% loss at the end of the century, mostly just due to warming of the climate system and the melting of that snow and the melting of that snow earlier, and also that snow falling as rain instead of as it would have historically. And so by the end of the century, you see just the highest parts of the Southern Sierra Nevada retaining much of their snowpack. We're also seeing in projections much lower soil moisture as we observed and experienced this year with extremely low soil moisture throughout the watershed, which contributed to the very low runoff rates this year. Even though we had a fairly decent snowpack this year, the runoff was very low partially because of the low soil moisture. So this starts to look at these changes in stream flow that we would experience as a result of that melting, that loss of the snowpack. So these traces, this is what's called a hydrograph. This is the trace of when precipitation or stream flow flows through our rivers. And the panel on the left is the Sacramento Four River Index. The one on the right is the San Joaquin Four River. And you can see that the black line is kind of the historical way that runoff has occurred. And so in the Sacramento, you can see it kind of ramps up until January, stays at that high level through May, and then starts to decline as that snowpack diminishes out historically. Whereas the San Joaquin, because those mountains are much higher, has a much later and more significant peak in May, as that snow melts out. Although, just keep an eye on the scale here. The Sacramento has about four times as much runoff coming off of it than the San Joaquin. So, these scales are different. So, the blue and the red line indicate mean projections across a number of climate models and scenarios. Again, by mid and late century. So, mid means kind of centered around the 2050 future period, whereas the end of the late century means the last 30 years of the 21st century. And you can see the shifting earlier in the year of this runoff and the much higher peaks in the winter season. Again, when I said we're we're managing for flood control and we can't capture that water and save it. And the lowering of the runoff during that dry season when we really can use it to refill reservoirs and deliver for our multiple benefits in the system and when it is most helpful for the ecosystem as well. The final projection of climate changes that I have here is looking at flooding in the Delta as a result of not just sea level rise, but that change in runoff that I just showed you. And so that runoff increasing during the winter months is also a flood risk for us downstream and particularly in the Delta. So what you're seeing here is a probabilistic look at potential flooding in the Delta as we move out into the 21st century. The darkest blue areas indicate the highest flood risk and the more likelihood of flooding on a more frequent recurrence. And the very lightest blue indicates that it would take something more than a 200-year event to flood those areas. And so right now, if you look out at the Delta, that 2020 likelihood, you see that flood protection out there is pretty good for most of the Delta, with the exception of Sassoon Marsh and the far left there. But those are, it's mostly agricultural area, or mostly agricultural and marshy areas out there that that are kind of designed to flood on a more frequent basis. But as we move out into the future, we see that large areas of the South and Central Delta become much more impacted by potential flooding, and some significant urban areas and legacy towns in the Delta would be affected by these changes. I want to clarify that one of the assumptions in this model is that levee elevations throughout the Delta stay at their current levels. They don't decrease with subsidence or consolidation. They also aren't raised with any new investments in levee improvements. And so we know that things will change in the future, but it's very hard to know exactly what those changes will be. The source of this information is the Delta Stewardship Council and their recent Delta Adapts report. And I noticed that several Delta Stewardship staff are on a call tonight. So I want to acknowledge all the great work that's in that study. So now with that, I will move into kind of the state and DWR's responses to climate change. So these are some pretty scary changes that are coming our way. You might be wondering, what's the state doing about this? So first of all, the state has been thinking about and addressing climate change for decades now. The California climate change assessments were on our fourth climate change assessment that was most recently released in 2018, which outlines a number of anticipated climate impacts by 2100 and looks at a wide array of sectors that would be affected, including the energy sector, water sector, agriculture, environmental justice communities, a number of academic studies and research funded through those projects. We also have the California Water Resilience Portfolio with more than 100 separate detailed actions to ensure California water systems work for our communities and our economy and the environment. And the Delta Conveyance Project is one of these responses, is part of the portfolio, as well as other significant infrastructure upgrades. The state also has an adaptation strategy and is working on an update to that strategy that looks at really four broad approaches: maintaining and diversifying water supplies, protecting and enhancing natural systems, building connections, and being prepared. As we know, there's a lot of uncertainty with climate change and just California's variable climate. And so being prepared for whatever comes our way is a major strategy there. And then finally, the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act passed in 2014. This is broad legislation that DWR is helping to implement that will help us manage our groundwater basin sustainably. And groundwater is really a hugely important water resource, particularly during drought periods. And so we really need to manage that resource more effectively and make sure we're not overpumping our aquifers during wet times so that that water is there during dry times. Moving on to what DWR specifically is doing to respond to climate change, DWR has a three-phase greenhouse gas emissions or a three-phase climate action plan that was first, the first phase was adopted in 2012 and then recently updated in 2020. And that's a greenhouse gas emissions reduction plan. This plan commits DWR to reducing GHG emissions by 60% below 1990 levels by 2030. So you can see a massive decrease there by 2030. And then by 2045, to be completely carbon neutral, using zero carbon resources for our operations. And DWR is a, the State Water Project in particular, is a very large user of energy. And so this is an important prong in the state's approach to reducing GHG emissions. The greenhouse gas emissions plan also outlines how individual projects that DWR does can be consistent with the plan and help contribute to this, the achievement of these goals. And the Delta Conveyance Project will be part of that and consistent with this plan. Phase two of the Climate Action Plan is really consistent climate change analysis across all DWR programs. This outlines how DWR will use technical rigor and the best scientific information to complete climate change analyses on the projects that it does. And also importantly outlines what DWR should be doing on its projects with respect to CEQA documents and climate change information and disclosure. And there again, this project is following those guidelines to make sure that it's providing information to the public on how climate change will impact the project and GHGs. And then finally, the third phase of DWR's Climate Action Plan is a vulnerability assessment and adaptation plan. This was finalized in 2019. It looked, vulnerability assessment looked at wildfire impacts, heat impacts, extreme heat impacts, particularly to folks maintaining the aqueduct and doing outdoor work, sea level rise, how that would impact Delta facilities and other coastal facilities, long-term persistent hydrologic changes, short-term extreme hydrologic changes, so the water supply impacts and the flood impacts, and then also habitat and ecosystem service impacts on DWR assets. And we're now currently working on an adaptation plan to implement and address many of the key vulnerabilities identified in that plan. Just a few other DWR responses to climate change beyond the Climate Action Plan. We're also looking at additional operational and infrastructure improvements to our facilities, including Delta Conveyance, but not Delta Conveyance exclusively, there are others. We're also investing heavily in watershed studies that would develop technical tools and resources and technical assistance for other watersheds and water managers throughout the state so that they can conduct climate change, rigorous climate change studies for their study areas and their operations and start to do the adaptation planning that they need to do. Moving to Action is a network of professionals involved in climate change and water resource management throughout the state and the nation that DWR is spearheading and bringing together and facilitating. And this is really about talking about what actions need to be taken, facilitating that action, getting people together and drawing, combining resources and drawing synergies out of those conversations. As I mentioned before, the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, or SGMA, is being implemented by DWR. DWR has provided a lot of the technical assistance and written much of the guidelines and the regulations for implementation of SGMA, and continues to provide important climate change information for the analysis of future impacts on groundwater that will be used in those plans. And then finally, integrated regional water management planning, which has been a flagship for DWR for decades, funding and facilitating regional cooperation and collaboration to build and implement strategies that make our water management more reliable and more resilient. So just to kind of sum up and take this home, just want to reiterate, California's current climate is highly variable. Climate change just increases that variability, and it leaves a lot of uncertainty for water managers. And so water management flexibility is and will continue to be a key objective to DWR in order to adapt to climate change and the uncertainty that it brings. And storing and moving water when it's available to meet water needs during dry periods has always been a key function of this SWP, and we intend to continue to operate under those principles. With that, I think I will turn it back over to Juliana And I think we may have time for some questions.
Thank you so much, Andrew. We'll spend a few minutes addressing the written questions received during Andrew's presentation. Carrie, do you want to cue those up?
Sure, thanks. So just a note, a number of the questions were about how Delta Conveyance is assessing climate change. And so I'm going to hold those questions for after our next presentation. Maggie Messerschmidt is going to be talking more about that. And I did want to answer one question that was actually during my presentation. So you received a question that says, has the work already started on the Delta Tunnel? My understanding is that land has already been moved. And I wanted to make sure we were really clear that no, the Delta Conveyance Project has not been approved and has not started any kind of construction. The only activities that are somewhat related are that we are looking at some soil investigations in the Delta. They were considered under a separate initial study and mitigated negative declaration. The purpose is to investigate geotechnical conditions within the Delta for to provide planning information for Delta Conveyance and increase DWR's over-understanding of Delta geology. So that does include some soil borings and cone penetration tests, but it's not moving any dirt. It's just borings to understand geotechnical conditions. There has been no approval and no construction. So with that, I'd like to ask Andrew a couple questions. The first, Andrew, a question asks, which islands pose the greatest risk of saltwater intrusion into the Delta, and what is being done or can be done to protect their dikes? And I was hoping you could talk a bit about DWR and other state agencies' efforts on this issue.
I think it's been generally shown that the far western islands are really, really important to maintaining salinity control in the Delta. Those levees have been improved over the last few years, and there is a Delta levees program that has been functioning throughout the Delta for, I believe, up like over 40 years. And so that continues to be an important source of funding for improving those levees moving forward. I don't think that the levees specifically are part of this project. So DWR has other projects and other programs that work on managing and improving those levees. Most of those levees are owned and maintained by private owners, local maintaining districts. And so DWR often contributes to the funding that those districts themselves put out to help maintain and improve those levees.
Thanks. And can you also talk a little bit about Delta Adapt? I know you mentioned it a little during your presentation, but just a little bit more about the assessment of flooding of islands and water. We also got a question related to water supply.
Sure. So Delta Adapts was the Delta Stewardship Council's vulnerability assessment for the Delta. It was completed, I believe it was finalized just earlier this summer. It covers a very wide range of resource impacts, water supply, flood, ecosystem, environmental justice, communities, extreme heat throughout the Delta. There's rigorous new analysis of pretty much agriculture as well of nearly all of those impacts. But I showed just one of the graphics from that report, but there's a lot of great information in there that talks about potential impacts of climate change on the Delta.
And then I think one more before we move on. You mentioned that the GHG reduction plan's goal of 60% reduction by 2030. Does the state account for wildfire smoke in evaluating and monitoring the state's ability to meet this goal? Now that the economy is more open and people are driving more, how well is the state doing towards reaching this goal?
So I can't speak directly to the state's goal of state writ large's goal of reducing greenhouse gas emissions and how wildfires would contribute to that. DWR's plan really just covers the activities for which we have authority and control over. So operation of the state water project, all of our fleet vehicles and electricity, heat, air conditioning in our buildings, and those kinds of activities. As I said, the state water project operations are a very large user of electricity, and so this is not insignificant at all. But the other thing I would say about wildfire is generally those emissions are not accounted for because they're not it's not fossil fuels being burned. That is kind of, the trees are kind of in the shorter term carbon cycle. It certainly isn't good for all of that carbon to be released into our atmosphere, but there is at least potential to, you know, regrow those trees and retrap that carbon in a shorter term than, say, burning coal or natural gas.
Thanks. So I think, Juliana, I think we can move on to Maggie's presentation when you're ready. Thanks, Andrew.
Great.
Thank you.
So let me turn things over to Maggie Messerschmidt, climate adaptation and resilience expert with ICF. Maggie will give a presentation on how climate change will be addressed in the draft environmental impact report. But first, Carrie is going to go over some introductory information. And as a reminder, please submit any questions you have about Maggie's presentation using the Q&A feature.
Thanks, Juliana. So before we jump into the environmental analysis, we did want to talk a little bit about the design process for the Delta Conveyance Project. We have taken a slightly different approach related to design than we will look at in the environmental document. So that's why Maggie's going to talk about the EIR. And before that, I just wanted to mention the design a bit. We have included really a set of conservative design assumptions to ensure the project is durable. So we considered the hydrologic changes with climate change at 2085. And so we used the Ocean Protection Council's 2100 H++ scenario for sea level rise of 10.2 feet at the Golden Gate. And I wanted to mention just quickly how conservative that is. The Ocean Protection Council identifies multiple different potential future scenarios for sea level rise. And, you know, they have a likely scenario and sort of less likely scenarios. And then they have the H++ scenario, which they don't even assign a probability to because it is unlikely. It is a scenario that reflects melting of the polar ice caps. So it's a pretty extreme scenario, but we wanted to make sure that as we work on the design of facilities, that because these are long-term facilities, that they would still be able to be used. They would not be inundated if there was climate change that reflected this type of scenario in the future. So the design elevations considered the sea level rise, and they were also based on a 200-year flood risk at 2085 that considers the hydrologic changes associated with climate change and changing runoff patterns into the future. So again, those are a little different because our objective was different. You know, with the EIR, we're looking at likely potential future conditions, reasonably foreseeable conditions. So for the design, we are looking at a condition that is more conservative so that we are really sure that this could be durable into the future. So I think, Juliana, with that, we can move on to Maggie.
Yeah, thanks. Maggie?
Okay, good evening, everyone. Great to be here. Thanks for being here also, and I look forward to our conversation at the end of this presentation. I want to start with the next slide, where we cover three ways that that climate change is being addressed in the draft EIR. The first is an analysis of air quality and greenhouse gas emissions, how the project could contribute to those greenhouse gas emissions. The second is that we are looking at hydrologic modeling that incorporates climate change projections to assess the impact of climate change on project operations. And the third is that since one of the primary purposes of the project is to enhance resiliency to climate change, we're looking at how the project could contribute to climate resiliency, especially for water resource reliability. Today, we're especially talking about numbers 2 and 3, the second and third bullets here, as the first bullet, the contribution to greenhouse gas emissions, is covered in a different part of the EIR. The hydrologic analysis incorporates sea level rise projections and downscale temperature and precipitation projections into a no project alternative analysis at 2040. That's to help understand how climate change will impact project operations. Those climate variables that I mentioned, sea level rise and temperature and precipitation, are then being considered directly in the development of the project design. Carrie talked about that. And then finally, you can see the diagram of how the models feed in, the climate change models feed into the hydrological models that in turn inform the both the climate change chapter and specific resource chapters. So the climate change modeling parameters that are being considered include this list here. So the time horizon that we're looking at is 2040. I do want to differentiate, though, that Carrie talks about how the design actually does look at a 2085 scenario. And then the primary models, we're using the 10 CMIP-5 global climate models under two greenhouse gas scenarios. That's RCP 4.5 and RCP 8.5. That stands for representative concentration pathways. Those 10 models are then at those two greenhouse gas scenarios then complete a 20 climate model ensemble. Those 20 models are then downscaled to a 2040 central tendency climate change scenario based on those temperature and precipitation predictions. So for sea level rise, in this analysis, we're also looking at an H++ scenario, so that extreme modeling scenario that Carrie described, with that occurs from loss of the ice sheet. That comes from the Ocean Protection Council's 2018 guidance, and that is 1.8 feet at 2040 in San Francisco. And then we're also looking at operations under the State Water Project and Central Valley Project. So you saw in the diagram before that these projections inform the CalSIM model, which is based on those operational and regulatory conditions. And those are the same conditions that we see today. And then all of that is incorporated into the analysis of the no project alternative in the resource chapters. Okay, so I mentioned those 20 models that were chosen. Those are chosen because they were chosen by a technical advisory group. You can see kind of, this is stream flow, but they're built off those temperature and precipitation projections that I mentioned. You can see the 64 models, and then 24 of those are chosen because they're most representative of the hydrological feature for California. Okay, so there are three central questions in the EIR that we are entertaining. The first one is how climate change could impact the study area itself. The second one is how could climate impacts to resources in the study area occur from climate change? What would that look like? And the third is how could the project affect the resiliency of the study area, particularly in regard to California water resources? And then we're looking at guidance. There is no current CEQA requirement around climate impacts analysis, but DWR in their phase two part of the study, the vulnerability assessment that Andrew was discussing, there is great guidance on incorporating climate change impacts for informational purposes, and that is the guidance we are following. So to look at climate trends, global climate trends that of course inform the our local climate trends, we're looking to the IPCC's report. Their last report in the fifth assessment was published in 2013. That's the physical science basis. And since then, there is a new report, you may have heard, the sixth assessment report. And so we are also working to update when we are able to update anything that we have written about the fifth assessment with the sixth assessment report. There's not major changes anticipated there, just kind of some increased certainty around some factors. And so any of the wording or edits that we need to provide will be based on the sixth assessment. And then of course, this is the basis for the California fourth assessment report, which if we go to the next slide, I show some studies that their reports that form part of the California fourth assessment and look at climate change impacts to the State Water Project. That's the Wang et al. Study. Schwartz et al. Looks at Central Valley Water Resource System. And then the summary report captures broader trends for California and different regions of California. And then we're also looking at some other relevant reports from he et al. and peer settle. These are especially relevant for the sea level rise downscaling that was done for California. All right, so Andrew talked us through some of these trends that we're expecting to see in the study area from climate change. And just want to reiterate that one of the objectives of the project too is to address sea level rise and some of these impacts, changes to runoff and our water systems. One thing that we are hoping to do with the EIR is to illustrate how the project is actually increasing resilience to these climate trends. Okay, so I'm just gonna walk us through, I mentioned those three questions, those three kind of guiding questions. I'm gonna walk us through how we are answering them. So the first one is, how could climate change impact the study area? We will be reviewing any recent trends and then climate change projections, both at mid-century and towards the end of the century, to inform our understanding of how climate change could impact the study area. Some of you have already been commenting, I see, on things you know about that. We will review expected climate impacts in the study area itself to understand how resources may be impacted by climate change. We will be reviewing the NOAA project alternative analysis conclusions at 2040 for other resources. And see how those could be creating changes to existing conditions. And then the third question, which is, how will the project affect the resiliency of the study area? We will be reviewing the resource chapters, which will be incorporating that 2040 analysis and the appendices that also would inform that, to assess how the project might increase resilience in the region to the effects of climate change, especially sea level rise, temperature changes, precipitation changes, drought, especially the climate variables that will affect our water resources. And with that, I will turn it back to Juliana.
Thank you, Maggie. There's a lot of questions, and as Carrie mentioned earlier, a lot of this is complex and technical data. We'll try to get as many of the written questions as possible and then go to verbal questions. So spend a couple minutes answering those written questions. I want to introduce Amardeep Singh, who's the Delta Conveyance Project Modeling Manager with the Department of Water Resources, who's available to help answer some of these questions. Carrie, do you want to focus on the questions?
Sure, thanks, Juliana. So we got a number of questions. I'm gonna sort of combine some questions so we can answer a number of them. We got a number of questions about whether the analysis of flood risk in the Delta, both through Delta Adapts as well as Delta Conveyance, assume that upstream reservoirs are not expanded, or we had a question about whether site's reservoir was included. I can't speak to Delta Adapts, Andrew might know more, but for Delta Conveyance, we are considering reasonably foreseeable projects. And so we have a set of criteria that we consider, including whether environmental planning and feasibility is complete, whether funding is secured. So at this point, expansions or new upstream reservoirs are not included in our future modeling conditions. Andrew, I think maybe you could add something about whether Delta Adapts includes additional upstream storage.
It does not assume that upstream storage will be built. It's worth noting too that, like, site's reservoir is an upstream storage reservoir. Its ability to reduce flood flows into the Delta is not huge. It's not like a new big on-stream reservoir. So yes, it would reduce the peak flows a little bit, but I don't think it would make a dent in some of those 200-year flows or things that would really cause flooding in the Delta.
Thanks. Maggie, we got a couple of questions on data sources and whether this is the most recent IPCC data, but maybe you could speak to that.
Yeah, I mentioned that there is a sixth assessment out from IPCC that, along with the science basis report that's coming from Working Group 1, there are a collection of CMIP MIP-6 model projections. Currently in California, there are a bunch of researchers working to downscale projections to California. But we won't have those updates in time for this project, but the fourth assessment, California's fourth assessment that was completed in 2018 does use downscaled projections from CMIP 5, and those are pretty darn good in the meantime. And so there are just constant ongoing efforts, I would say, to be updating. And as soon as we can use that information, we do use that information.
So we have a question about some of the construction efforts and how they could be affected by changing climate. So the question is about the idea that we are already seeing changes in climate related to drought and reduced snowpack. And it seems clear that there would be fewer but more extreme winter precipitation events. And so the question asks how heavy downpours and major storms could affect tunnel excavation, runoff on sites. Would there be increased, how would runoff and water quality be managed at a site? Would there be erosion from construction sites? And so a lot of this is actually being addressed through the Delta Conveyance Design and Construction Authority as part of the conceptual designs is working to manage the potential for runoff and erosion. So the sites that would be storing materials and stockpiles have levees surrounding them that would contain everything within the site. So there would not be erosion and runoff off the site. All of that water is being captured for reuse and treated. Additionally, they are planning to accommodate the storm events and heavy downpours. I think that we will, you know, it is an interesting question whether they've calculated that based on increased potential for storm events. And that's something that I can check into. Maggie, I'm not sure if you have the answer to that one, but I think we can look into that and confirm. It's an interesting question. Okay, so we'll follow up on that. We had a number of questions also about how we're looking at salinity intrusion associated with sea level rise. So, you know, as we're talking about sea level rise, We expect salinity to push further into the delta, and that freshwater saline zone is important and potentially problematic for fish and agriculture. And so people were asking if and how we are evaluating salinity intrusion and the potential effects of the Delta Conveyance Project.
Sure, yeah. So salinity intrusion is being looked at in the water quality assessment. So those sea level rise projections are incorporated into a model. If you go back up to if you want to share the modeling slide again, so you can see the sea level rise flow salinity. There's actually models that are informed by this schism, which is based on those H++ scenarios across the time horizons that we were discussing there. So for water quality in particular, they're looking at the 2040 to 2100 time frame.
Thanks. And we had a couple of mentions about Delta water exports and water supplies. So other studies such as Delta Adapt from the Delta Stewardship Council have talked about water exports potentially becoming less reliable in the future, regardless of wet or dry years. The question is, how will the EIR reflect the reliability of supplies into the future?
Yeah, I think in multiple ways. I think one thing that we are trying to understand is, what is the role of this tunnel in increasing reliability south of the Delta area. So I think also understanding how storage requirements and flooding earlier in the year might change in regards to that earlier runoff. So I think we're thinking of this project as one, not necessarily a silver bullet, but one of many projects that are underway to increase reliability of the broader system. So anything you would add to that, Carrie?
Yeah, I think that was the key point. I think that sort of back to our project objectives, that is a main reason we're considering this project, that we are concerned about the potential future reliability concerns associated with some of the things that Andrew discussed, you know, the change in precipitation, so more rainfall, less snowpack, and the sort of flashier storms that we've also discussed. And so Delta Conveyance is a way to potentially try to address some of those things. And that's something that we are evaluating, whether it would increase resilience as part of the evaluation that Maggie was discussing. And then a quick question, what is the study area for climate change?
The study area includes the project, the entire project footprint and any, surrounding, we're really looking at quite a large footprint. So the entire project footprint.
Okay. And I have a fairly technical question, so we might want to pull Emmer deep in for this one, but how are the evaporative effects of rising atmospheric temperatures being factored into CalSim modeling? Are those assumptions altered or adjusted with succeeding CMIP5 to CMIP6 and RCPs?
Yeah, I'll pass that one to Amrit.
Okay.
Here. So yeah, in terms of taking evaporation changes in CalSim models, so we are, based on different global models that we selected, we are changing inputs in CalSim for evaporation and taking into account while we're doing modeling for the future scenarios.
So Juliana, I think we can probably move on to verbal questions.
Great. Let me remind people how to participate in the verbal questions. We're going to spend the rest of the time going through these verbal questions. And if there's any time left, we'll go revisit any written questions that we haven't gotten time to. Please keep in mind that these should be clarifying questions or questions that will help you understand the background information when you review the draft EIR. If you have any questions on the content covered in the evening, this evening, raise your hand and you will be placed in the queue. As a reminder, you can raise your hand by clicking on the raise hand icon on the bottom of your screen. When your name is called, unmute your mic and you will have 2 minutes to ask your question. I keep a list. I'll do my best to call on people in the order in which their hands are raised. For those of you who are participating by phone, you can raise your hand by pressing *9 and then *6 to unmute yourself when you're called on. If anybody has a follow-up question after I call on you, please just get back into the queue by raising your hand again. I'll try and get back to you, but I also want to make sure that lots of people have a chance to ask their questions. So I have in the queue Lane Fajot, Nancy, and Ty Vaughn. When we unmute you, I wonder if you can tell us your whole name so we just know who's talking. So Lane Fajot, are you still there? Nope. Okay, then let's call on Nancy. I'm sorry, I don't know your last name. Nancy, you just have to unmute your, yep, there you go.
Okay. All right, my name's Nancy Glastos. I live in Redlands. And what I'm worried about is the salt water intrusion into the Delta and how it's gonna affect the disadvantaged people in the area because they won't have drinking water. I know that the water flows to mitigate against that. But I don't see how with the raising sea levels, I've listened to you that can be kept fresh, like fresh water, the salinity.
Thanks, Nancy. So Andrew or Maggie or Amardeep or Carrie, how does this project address salinity?
Well, I can start by framing the question a bit. So we are looking, as part of our EIR, we are really focused on the effects of a potential Delta Conveyance project. So we're looking at how a Delta Conveyance project would potentially change the environment compared to what would be happening in the baseline. And so we are comparing primarily the Delta Conveyance project to a baseline under existing conditions. So we will be looking at the potential for Delta Conveyance to affect salinity in the Delta specifically under those conditions. We will also be looking at a future no project without Delta Conveyance, and that does capture climate change and any potential changes to salinity and other water quality parameters in the Delta. So while it is not required by CEQA, we are going to have an appendix that does look at Delta Conveyance under those future conditions as well to see if it would change the way that Delta Conveyance affects the environment if we look at it with climate change. That will be in an appendix. We don't need to include it for CEQA. It's not the way that CEQA requires the analysis, but we're doing it because we think it's good for disclosure. So that affects that addresses sort of the straight water quality effect. But I think you were also talking a bit about disadvantaged communities and if they would be affected. And I did want to just have a little advertisement for our next workshop. So our next workshop is actually going to be on environmental justice and focusing on how we're analyzing effects to environmental justice communities. So I'd like to put in a plug for that on September 14th. So we're hoping you can make it. But again, we will be focusing a lot on the effects of the project. So if the project would be increasing effects to the disadvantaged communities, I think that there is the potential for them to be affected by the baseline climate change conditions as well. I don't know if anyone else on the team has something to add to that.
I guess I would just add to that that salinity in the Delta is a function of the regulations that govern Delta water quality that are set by the State Water Resources Control Board, not DWR or anybody else. And so the project, with or without a tunnel, is operated to meet those requirements for water quality. Sea level rise certainly makes meeting those requirements difficult, and we end up probably currently releasing some of our stored water to repel that salinity that is the result of the sea level rise that we've already seen. So that's kind of how the system works now and in the future. The project operates to the requirements. That's what governs, and those requirements are met first before deliveries are made.
Andrew, that was a really important addition. Thank you. We hear a lot of concern at other meetings as well, that people are concerned that by having a North Delta diversion in addition to the South Delta, DWR would be less inclined to manage water quality in the Delta. And I guess I wanted to flag that we have to, it's the law. So even, you know, if we have a system of dual conveyance, it is still important to us because we are planning to use the South Delta facilities. But aside from that, we are required to meet those requirements from the State Water Resources Control Board. So it would still be a requirement either way.
Yeah, and I one thing I would add to that is that the intakes aren't directly from the Delta itself. It's north of the Delta, so that, you know, that might just help to clarify that we're not talking about intakes that come directly from the areas facing high salinity.
Thanks. So next in the queue, I have Tai Vong.
Let me be as direct about where
I can't. Sorry, that was very hard to hear you. There was an echo. Tai, we'll see if you need to fix your audio and we'll come back to you. I saw that Lane Fajot got back into the queue. Lane, are you still there? Lost you. Okay. Katie Wagner, you're next in the queue. Do you want to unmute yourself?
Hi. So Carrie, you just answered a question. I just want to point out that you said the webinar, the next one's on September 14th. It's September 16th. And then additionally, so the question was about a no tunnel alternative. I think that we're forgetting that it seems like the paradox is a complete do nothing alternative or this huge $40 billion environmentally destructive project. But there is also the option that we don't build the tunnel, but do more to repair local levees, repair the things that need to be repaired at the Delta. It really shouldn't be just do nothing or build this huge tunnel. And I don't think that's something that has been considered enough. Can you speak more to why that isn't something that DWR has looked at?
Yeah, so Katie, first of all, thank you for fixing my slip up. You're right, absolutely. It is September 16th, not the 14th, and I hope that people can attend. So as for the alternatives, we as DWR, our goal for this project, the fundamental reason we're considering it, is to allow the State Water Project to continue to function in the face of many problems. So having an alternative that would allow the State Water Project to continue to degrade, to not address the concerns associated with climate change and sea level rise and earthquake risk, that does not meet our objectives. That said, we understand that if the State Water Project continued to degrade, local water agencies would likely undertake projects such as recycling and desalination and potentially increase conservation if they can, and potentially increased groundwater storage or other types of local projects. So we are working to incorporate those in our no project alternative. So our no project alternative does look at a programmatic level analysis of of implementation of those types of projects in addition to sort of just no change in the State Water Project diversion facilities.
Thank you. Carol de Sa Campos.
Hi, yes, Carol de Sa Campos here, but I'm sure this is a dumb question, but I would like to clarify one thing. Do the intakes north of the Delta in any way affect or reduce the amount of fresh water that flows or would flow potentially through the Delta?
So if water is diverted at the North Delta, it would potentially change diversion patterns. So one of the things that we're trying to capture with this new North Delta diversion would be to look at capturing flows when it is available. I'm not sure if you participated in the last workshop, but we talked a little bit about the operational criteria that we would apply. Essentially, we can only divert at those North Delta facilities a substantive amount if flows are high. The focus is trying to capture higher flows. So it would have a small decrease of the freshwater moving into the Delta, but because there are requirements for how much flow must move past those intakes, and it would be at times of high flow, the goal is to try to avoid effects to the Delta by having those diversions.
Thank you. Carrie, there's nobody with their hand up at the moment. Do you want to answer one of the other written questions?
Sorry, I'm just going back to look. Okay, so we had a question about the range of capacity of the alternatives. So why is there a range of 3,000 to 7,500 CFS? And what has the flow at the intake locations been historically in periods of drought? So I guess a couple of thoughts here. One of them is about the flows during periods of drought. So as I mentioned during the response to the last question, we did talk a little bit about the criteria that we would use to divert water during our last meeting, and we could not divert water during low flow conditions. So during drought years, there are often storms that have flashy flows, and it might be possible to divert water in those short-term periods. But for the most part, in drought years, the Delta Conveyance Project wouldn't be operating very much. It would be very minimal. So during drought years, If there is low flow, we wouldn't be taking water. It wouldn't be changing the flow coming into the Delta. And in terms of the range of capacity, a lot of that range of capacity is based on comments we received. So we had a proposed project of 6,000 CFS. We did identify a potential range based on things that we heard going up to release of the notice of preparation. And we did in fact receive comments about trying to include alternatives that had different capacity ranges. So we're looking at lower and higher capacity so that we can see if that changes the range of potential effects.
Thank you. We have Bob Venning in the queue.
All right, this follows up on that question about the capacity and in drought years. I wonder if it isn't a bit naive to believe that if there's a terrible drought, the law won't be changed. I wonder if the capacity won't be used if there are a lot of people down there that need water. I think that perhaps that's worth thinking about. In other words, you're drawing boundaries that may not really prevail if the rubber meets the road. Now, that's not exactly a question, more of a statement. I'm sorry to have to make it, but I view this as something that I've lived through. I'm older perhaps than all of you. I can remember the mid 70s when there was a terrible drought. Here in Northern California, we couldn't use water to wash cars, and you could see pictures of people in Los Angeles spraying their cars with water for some reason or another, and I don't want that to happen again.
So thanks, Bob. You know, I've heard that concern before, that during drought conditions, there may be additional diversions, and I think a couple of thoughts on that. One of them is that we will not be permitted to do anything higher. You know, we will have it's not just DWR's decision about how much we would want to divert. In addition to our environmental compliance documents, we will also have permits from the Department of Fish and Wildlife under the California Endangered Species Act, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service and National Marine Fisheries Service for the Federal Endangered Species Act. We'll have to follow water rights requirements under our water rights from the State Board, and we'll have to follow water quality requirements that are part of the Water Board's overall regulatory efforts. So I guess what I'm saying is there's a lot of regulation. So it's, I think that, I mean, DWR is still subject to the environmental documents that it puts out, but But in addition, there are a lot of other protections in place to avoid us diverting more than we are permitted to divert.
Thank you. Tim Strohshane, do you want to unmute yourself?
Thank you very much. My question is, does DWR and ICF Consulting expect to be using CMIP6 from the 6th IPCC report, downscaled projections for California for the draft EIRS by the spring of 2022? We think you should, because if you don't, you'll be vulnerable to a charge that you won't have the best available science for the EIR, EIS on the DCP.
Maggie, maybe you can address this one.
Sure, yeah. Tim, it'd be great to hear, I guess, what CMIP 6 downscaled information will be available for use at that time. But like I said, we are incorporating any additional findings from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and would certainly incorporate into any trends, any latest studies. So I think the big question is whether, you know, the modeling that is being performed is, the timeline is aligned with that, with the release date of any updated CMIP 6 information.
I don't see anybody else in the queue. So let me go through the next steps for this. So thank you so much for attending. People often ask how many people were here, not panelists, et cetera. At the height of the presentation, there was 129 attendees, not panelists, but attendees. So thanks so much. That's a lot of people. I know that we probably didn't get to everybody's questions, but there will be other ways to answer those questions. So as we noted earlier, the presentations for this evening are currently available on the Department of Water Resources website and were sent out this afternoon as well. To view or download, go to the informational webinars page on the Delta Conveyance section of the Department of Water Resources website. Once you're on that page, scroll down to the topics, set schedule and registration section, and you'll find a link to the presentation under the header for this evening's webinar. There'll also be a video recording of this event available on the Department of Water Resources website. All the previous videos for these informational webinars are also there. The first one and the second one have been posted, and so you'll find the other ones there also. If you have a question that Department of Water Resources or ICF were not able to answer tonight, or if you think of something after the event, you can send an email to deltaconveyance@water.ca.gov. We will prepare, Department of Water Resources will prepare a frequently asked questions document to answer any clarifying questions related to climate change at the topic of the webinar, and they'll post it to that project website. As Carrie mentioned, there's one more upcoming informational webinar on September 16th, which will cover environmental justice, and we really hope to see all of you at the event. This slide that you're seeing has information on how to get in touch and how to stay updated on project news and information. Thank you so much for everyone participating. We hope to see you at another informational webinar. Thank you.